I'd like to welcome you to the United Way of Greater Los Angeles Education Summit. Please welcome Jana Greer, President and CEO of Sun America Retirement Markets, United Way Board Member, and Chairperson of the United Way Education Summit Task Force.
Good morning. I cannot tell you, standing up here from this podium and knowing the number of people that we have signed up for this event throughout the day, over 1,000 people, how exciting it is for all of us that we've been able to bring together business and labor and parents and teachers, community agencies, civic activists, all together for one purpose and for one purpose only, to ensure the future of our students and our community. You know, this is one of the first times I've ever seen such a diverse community that's brought together on this really important topic of education. Today, we hope at the United Way that this is the beginning of many conversations of this type going forward. You know, today more than ever, education is the determinant of who will and who will not wind up in poverty. And education more than ever is the determining factor that drives whether we will or we will not be competitive in a global economy. Often the conversation today is about how broken our school system is, and it is true that over the last 10 years, despite the efforts of so many people, that graduation rate in Los Angeles County hovers still at that 60% rate, which is unacceptable. But the one thing that I have to tell you about today is today we are going to focus on educational models that are working. We're going to talk about best practices. We're going to talk about how we can bring those models to scale for the benefit of everyone in Los Angeles County and particularly for our students. We have an exciting program for you. This morning, Kati Haycock from the Education Trust is going to be with us to lead off talking about the state of education, both here in Los Angeles County, but in the state of California, the United States, and literally our competitiveness around the world. That will be followed by the mayor and then a series of very exciting panels and panelists. I could not be more proud of the types of speakers and leaders we've brought together for you today. They also come from all parts of the community. They come from business, they come from labor, they come from parents, they come from our educational system. And that's because we wanted to have a rich diversity of thought around this very important issue today. Beginning at 10 o'clock, I think you all know, we have two different sessions that are going on of panelists, so we'll be in two different rooms. And those, one will be about supporting our teachers, how we build and foster and nurture great teachers in our school system. And the second one about school leadership. How do we surround those teachers and those classrooms with the kind of leadership that can enable us to get to the promised land where we need to be with our educational system, specifically focusing on principals who are beating the odds and how we can model their success and take that broadly across Los Angeles County. And then the piece de resistance at noon, we have the U.S. Secretary of Education, Arne Duncan, as our keynote speaker. So we're very pleased with the program that we're going to be able to bring you today, and we thank all of our speakers and panelists in advance. Now, before we start the formal part of the program, I would like to take just a moment to thank many of the people who have made today possible. First of all, the members of our Education Summit Task Force. They have joined me and worked tirelessly to make this day possible. If you are here, would you please stand out in the audience? I can't see out there very well. Thank you. While they are standing, I want you to know that throughout United Way and all year long, we have volunteers who are working and analyzing and making better our partnerships throughout the community. So please also stand our Community Investment Cabinet. If you're a member of that cabinet out in the audience, please stand. These days don't happen without sponsors. Our generous sponsors for today include Mattel, Target, Farmers Insurance, and the James Irvine Foundation, just to name a few. And to our lead sponsor, Deloitte, without your support, I can honestly say that this day would not have happened. Thank you so much to Deloitte. I also want to recognize and honor the four companies who are major contributors to the United Way Pathways Out of Poverty Plan. Those are Bank of America, Enterprise Rent-A-Car, UPS, and Wells Fargo. And last but not least, our local elected officials, and I know that some are joining us a little bit later this morning, and some are actually panelists, so they're backstage. But I would like to call out their names: L.A.U.S.D. board members Yoli Flores, Steve Zimmer, and Nuri Martinez; L.A.U.S.D. board president Monica Garcia, and city controller Wendy Gruhl. If you're here and out in the audience, would you please stand? And finally, I would like to acknowledge the United Way of Greater Los Angeles Board of Directors, and most particularly our amazing chair, Caroline Nahas. You know, I've been involved with this board for quite some time, and I can tell you that it is not just a board that is engaged. I believe it's a board that exhibits immense, tremendous courage. You know, when you start out to do something like Pathways Out of Poverty and to create that kind of plan, at times it means you're going to have to confront the tough issues, because they're related to the work that we are trying to do to move people out of poverty in our community. And that means education, homelessness, financial stability. And to all of those issues, they bring passion and commitment. Will our board members please stand? Now, before I introduce Kati Haycock, I want you to meet a very special individual, a young man by the name of Antonio Cabrera. He's here today to talk with us about some of his struggles in school, but more importantly, his ultimate successful high school graduation. You know, we're going to be discussing a lot of data today, and a lot of speakers are going to talk with you. But Antonio is here to remind us that it's not just about the data, even though that's tremendously important to get to the solutions that we need. It's about one simple thing: putting our kids first. Please welcome Antonio Cabrera.
Thank you. Hey, what's up, everybody? This is a little nerve-wracking, so bear with me. My name is Antonio Cabrera, and I was once considered a high school dropout in East Los Angeles. I was part of a large percentage of youth that was pushed out of traditional high schools, not only in L.A., but in most low-income communities of color across the country. I was 16. I felt alone and ignored. My teachers had their hands full with 40-plus students in the classroom, with over 3,000 students on campus at one time in a school built for only 1,500. Teachers and counselors had a hard time when it came to individual time with students. Many students felt left out and unaccounted for. I was one of them. After my third year in high school, I dropped out. After just 2 months, however, I realized I wanted to go back and finish school. I didn't see a future in the work I was doing. I felt like I was a bad influence on my friends and family because they looked at me as an example. I would always tell them to do well in school, but they always shrugged me off, thinking that since I was a dropout, I was the last person that should be telling them anything about that subject. I pushed myself to go back to school. I was 2 years behind in my credits and decided that the best option was an adult school. I attended the Roosevelt Garfield Adult School in East Los Angeles. I worked really hard and pushed myself to achieve my goal graduating. It took me 6 months to catch up and receive both my GED and my high school diploma. I graduated 2 weeks before my peers and friends at my former high school, and I became the first person in my family to receive a high school diploma in the United States. Gracias. After my graduation ceremony, I felt that I had done it all for myself because I did it on my own. But that feeling quickly changed after I saw everyone around me rejoice at my victory. I am now studying film and theater arts at Santa Monica College and plan on transferring to UC Berkeley in 2 years. I have a growing concern that my little sisters and my cousins will have a similar experience if something doesn't change soon. I can still remember how I felt at 16. I felt hopeless, and I don't want them to feel the same way I did. When I was in elementary, I don't recall schools having to worry about layoffs, limited supplies, or the future for the school itself. It's not a secret that our schools were not created for everyone to graduate, especially not the ones in my neighborhood. But that's exactly why we're here today, to begin to change that reality. I want my siblings and other young folks to feel like they have their teachers' full attention and to make it easier for our educators to concentrate on what the real issues are, which is getting students to graduate and move on to higher education. I attended a teacher rally last Tuesday that took place at the doorstep of the L.A.U.S.D. building. I saw the frustration and determination in their eyes, and it gave me goosebumps. I had never seen a teacher so fired up about something that wasn't my fault. People think that the youth doesn't care about what happens in our schools or anywhere else. But when we lose a teacher because of layoffs, we lose more than just a teacher. We lose a role model. So it's pretty hard not to care. Many of us don't have the support that these teachers offer us at home. So when they're gone, who will we turn to for help on access to college and basic motivation towards our education? I am here today to urge decision makers to take the appropriate steps and to make the right decisions to keep as many quality teachers inside the classroom, have basic resources for learning and updated technology, and to keep the students' hopes of graduating higher education alive. I also want to encourage education leaders to not give up and to keep encouraging the youth and their parents to fight for the rights to a quality education. I understand it's a complex situation we find ourselves in, but with the persistence and the will of the people involved, I'm sure we could better our situation. We have to keep optimistic, not only for ourselves, but for those who come after us. Our little brothers and sisters, our sons and daughters who aspire to become our next teachers, leaders, marine biologists, police officers, without us taking action today, those dreams will not become reality. Thank you for being here today, and you know that when someone like me gets to speak to a room full of people like you, something's going to change soon. Thank you.
Thank you. Now you know why you were the ones who got up and got to this wonderful venue at 8 o'clock this morning. It's to hear Antonio and to know what we're all working toward. Because it's not just our moral obligation, and it's not just an economic imperative. It's because we owe it to students like Antonio, the first of his family to graduate, and to young people like him all over Los Angeles County. Now I have the great privilege of introducing Kati Haycock. Kati is the president of the Education Trust, and if you've not had an opportunity to work with them before, the Education Trust has been known for years as a very powerful voice on education policy. It is often described as the most important truth teller in American public education, working to ensure that all of our students, regardless of race or income or background, get the education they so richly deserve. The Trust works hand in hand with educators and with civic leaders to transform schools all over the United States. Please give a very warm welcome to Kati Haycock.
Good morning. Like many of you, I am a child of Los Angeles. My great-grandmother, on my mom's side, emigrated to Los Angeles from Germany at age 16, alone with her sister, in search of a better life. And yes, she cleaned houses for a living, but she did so in the belief that her children would not have to. And my father's mother, like many of yours, immigrated from Mexico at about the same age. Her family was drawn by the sense of opportunity and possibility that still today draws many to Los Angeles. And this city, and in particular, the Los Angeles Unified School District, delivered for my family as they did for so many at that time. Belmont High School equipped my grandmother. George Washington High School equipped my mother and father with the solid basic skills that they needed to find decent jobs and to enter a solidly middle-class existence. In those days, of course, modest skills were enough if you were willing to work hard. But what is important for us to remember this morning, as we begin our conversation together about what the data tell us, is today nothing, no amount of hard work will compensate for weak academic skills. To have a decent chance in this economy, young people need not only a high-quality K-12 education, but post-secondary credentials as well. So my role this morning is to kind of take you on a quick walk through what the data tell us about where we are now on that measure. So let's take a look. All of you know in this room that early reading, I think we're having problems advancing the slides here. Here we go. Early reading is hugely important. If young people don't complete third or fourth grade with solid reading skills, they have almost not a prayer of succeeding in the rest of their education. But what you're looking at right there is what the California assessment results tell us about where Los Angeles children are right now. And just a quick clue to what you're seeing, wherever you see green, those are the kids about whom you should feel just fine. They're doing okay. Yellow kids are just below that. Red kids, wherever you see red, you want to worry. Those are the kids that aren't even close. So what do you see there? Roughly for white students, roughly 85% of Los Angelino young people. For Asians, roughly 85% are doing just fine. For African American Latinos, as you can see, fewer than half. So let's take a look at eighth grade math. Just as fourth grade reading skills are hugely important, so too is eighth grade mathematics. Kids that don't succeed in solid eighth grade mathematics don't have a chance of succeeding in the rigorous high school college prep sequence. But look at the numbers today. You don't have to stare at that chart very long to see the differences. No group of children in Los Angeles doing particularly well on this measure. But as you can see, once again, Latinos and African Americans are doing considerably worse than other students. And what about those college prep courses that young people need in order to have a fighting chance of both entering our four-year colleges or, frankly, even succeeding in our two-year colleges? You don't have to look at those charts very long to see significant numbers of Los Angeles children, especially Latino and African American children, not getting the courses they need. So I want you to hold these numbers in your head, but I want you to hold them in your head because they're the best numbers that you're going to see over the next few minutes. Because the good news is what you just saw. The bad news is when these same children take the national examinations, their results are considerably worse. So remind you, okay, so here's what the numbers look like on the California test. Here's what happens when those same children take the national test. How about 8th grade mathematics? Again, here's what you're reporting to parents in Los Angeles right now. Here's what happens when those same children take the national examinations. Look at the difference. What about those kids taking the college prep courses? Well, a fair number of them are taking the courses, but what happens when they take the examination that they have to pass to avoid remediation? Take a look at those numbers. And remember when you look at those numbers that you're talking there about the students who make it to 11th and 12th grade. Significant numbers of children here in Los Angeles, as I certainly don't need to tell you, don't even make it that far. So I know there are a lot of people in this room who say, what do you expect, right? We have large numbers of English language learners in this city, large numbers of Latino and African American children, large numbers of low-income children. What do you expect? Surely we can't expect them to perform well on standardized tests. The problem with that kind of thinking, and there's a lot of it in California today, is it doesn't explain why kids in so many other cities are performing significantly better than children right here in Los Angeles. Here's what the latest numbers tell you. Okay? That's a look at where Los Angeles children perform compared to other major cities. As you can see there, fifth from the bottom. Well, I know some of you are looking at those numbers and you're still saying, yeah, well, Charlotte and Austin, they probably have more affluent white kids. So let me just show you what it looks like if you just compare like kids. So let's look, for example, at low-income Latino children across participating school districts. That's what you're looking at there. Take a look at where low-income Latino children are in Los Angeles, fourth from the bottom. That, by the way, is about 2 to 3 grade levels below low-income Latino children in Miami, in Charlotte, in New York City, or in Boston. What about low-income African-American children? As you can see there, fifth from the bottom. And that, by the way, in fourth grade reading, by fourth grade, these youngsters are more than 2 grade levels below low-income black children in Boston, Houston, or in Charlotte. What about if you turn to eighth grade mathematics? Again, when you look at Los Angeles as a whole, fifth from the bottom. When you look at numbers for Latino students, Latinos here in Los Angeles, low-income Latinos, are third from the bottom, more than 2 grade levels below their counterparts in the city of Houston. Low-income African-American children, third from the bottom, about 2.5 grade levels below their counterparts in Austin, Boston, Charlotte, or New York City. And when you look at the data in science, as you can see, not very pretty either. About 2.5 grade levels below the national average. Now, I know those of you who are educating your children outside of Los Angeles Unified School District are saying to yourself, well, maybe that's just the Los Angeles Unified School District. And my response to that is, don't kid yourself. When you look at the data for California as a whole, it's hardly any more encouraging. If you look, for example, at fourth grade reading results for the country as a whole, that's every state up there on the screen. State on the left is doing the best, state on the right is doing the worst. Difference between best and worst is at least 2 years of learning, whereas California, right there. How about when you just look at Latino youngsters, okay? It's Latinos in every state. Where are Latinos in California? Right there. How about African Americans? African Americans in California, a little bit better, but still considerably below the national average. How about low-income children? Where are low-income children in California compared to low-income children elsewhere? Right there, next to the bottom. Those of you who are from high-income families are saying, well, at least that's not me. So let me show you where your children are. Not so hot either, right? So what about eighth grade mathematics? Again, the patterns are very similar. Overall, every kid, every state, whereas California, right there, fourth from the bottom. How about Latinos in every state, where Latinos in California, second from the bottom. Where African Americans in California compared to African Americans in other states, third from the bottom. How about white students? How are they doing? A little better, but still considerably below the average for white students in the country as a whole. So literally, no matter how you look at the data, the overall picture isn't so good. Now, those of you who know me know that this is the point in the talk where I normally turn the corner, right? After showing you horrifying data that makes your hair stand on end and makes your heart hurt, I turn the corner, I tell you stories about schools in this city that are hitting it out of the park for very poor kids. Schools that every single day are proving that these kids can. And I'll show you data that says, yeah, you know, while the results are pretty bad, we're getting better. And in fact, that's true. That's true. When you look at the data for Los Angeles, you see all groups are getting better. But here's the important thing for you to remember. Nobody else is standing still either. So look at the data here. Los Angeles up 8 points on the national exams in the last 6 years, but look at DC, Atlanta, San Diego, and Boston, considerably more. How about Latino students? Los Angeles 4 points up in the last 6 years, but look at DC, Charlotte, Boston, Chicago, considerably more. Same thing when you look at the data on Latinos for eighth grade mathematics. LA up 14. But not up as far as its counterparts in DC and Boston and San Diego. And finally, the numbers here for African Americans show a very similar pattern. If we can get them up there, here we go. So again, Los Angeles up, but not nearly as far up as is true in other states. The question you ought to be asking yourselves is, should you be mad about all this? And my answer to you is damn straight you should be mad about all this. Damn straight you should be mad about all this. But let's be clear here. This is not about blame. You know, it's really popular now to be blaming teachers, to be blaming principals. This is not about blame. I think one of the things that you and I need to acknowledge is that if anybody deserves the blame in California, it's us. It's those of us who call us ourselves Californians. We deserve the blame for demanding too little of our own children. We deserve the blame for demanding too little for other people's children. And we deserve the blame for both demanding too little of our schools and for not caring enough to fund them well enough to provide what our kids need. So until we change that fundamental aspect of our character, until we decide that we need more for our children, no superintendent, no mayor, no school board president can turn this around. So get mad, but then get busy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Katie. Now you know why we are all here. Now you know what the challenge is ahead of us, and you also know what the great opportunity is if together we work to solve the problem of the numbers you just heard. To carry us further into that dialogue, I have the great privilege this morning of introducing to you the mayor of the city of Los Angeles, Antonio Villaraigosa. I have to share with you a little bit of backstage knowledge. You know, when I was out here a little bit earlier and I introduced Antonio Cabrera, I referred to him as a wonderful young man, and our mayor thought he was on next. So I got pretty excited about that. So I am going to introduce him as a wonderful young man, because if there was anyone who is young at heart, who is an education warrior, who's been fighting to improve our schools for many years, it is our mayor. While in the California Assembly, he spearheaded a major effort to both rebuild and modernize schools across the state, and he continues that work as our mayor, shutting down failing schools, reconstituting them as innovative campuses, public charters, or members of partnership schools. Please join me in welcoming Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa.
She walked out and said, "Gotcha." First of all, let me acknowledge, you know, I grew up in a home where we served ourselves. So whenever I'm served, I like to thank the people that served me. Let's give a big hand to the servers here at And she's right when she said, "I have a young man named Antonio." I thought she was talking about me. And then I got to hear Antonio. And let me just say something about how hopeful I am about the future when I know that there are young people like Antonio. He didn't drop out. He was pushed out. A young man with clearly great writing skills, an ability to articulate, a young man that's going places. But think about all of the Antonios that we've lost. When you look at the numbers that they were going through, and I've been talking about this for, 5.5 years as mayor, it boggles the mind, the number of brilliant young men and women that we've lost, that won't graduate from high school, won't go on to college. Maybe sometime later on we'll get a few years or a few classes in college, maybe make up their high school education with a GED. But think about what we could have done. And I say that from experience, because as I said to Antonio when he walked back in, I was a high school dropout. I was pushed out. But thank God, I had a public school that gave me a second chance, a public school teacher, Herman Katz, who along with my mom helped me along the way. Went on to East LA College, not Santa Monica, UCLA. He wants to go to Berkeley, and then law school after that. And the passion that I have for this issue has everything to do with the fact that I know intuitively that there are a lot of people like Antonio, and we've got to do something about it. Those statistics that we just saw were so chilling. I remember 5 years ago talking about a 50% dropout rate, and a newspaper and almost everyone else saying, "Oh no, it's not that high. No, 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 no." 5 studies later, some of them we commissioned, affirmed what most of us knew. In some schools, it's a lot higher. We have disproportionately here in this city, but all across the country, as you saw from those statistics, dropout factories. Places where people are dropping out in numbers that just boggle the mind. And so I am very, very happy, and I want to thank all of you for being here today to participate in the United Way Education Summit, and for realizing that every one of us, as we heard a few minutes ago, are stakeholders in this public school system of ours. I want to thank the business leaders who are here for recognizing that our schools are not only an anchor for our communities, they're a gateway for the prosperity and for our competitive standing. You know, if when I say to people that this is the economic issue of our time, and if our kids can't read and write, we're going to be in a situation where we're not going to be able to compete in a global economy predicated on intellectual capital. It's the democracy issue of our time, because if our kids can't read and write, they can't participate in a meaningful way in our democracy. It's the civil rights issue of our time. It's the civil rights issue of our time when you look at the numbers there and you see disproportionately these kids come from certain communities, from poor communities. They're kids of color. And so I want to thank as well philanthropy for helping us to build public-private partnerships. I want to for transforming a large underperforming school district is an enormous challenge. But transforming one as large as this one can only be supported with the financial resources and the support of our philanthropic community and the support of the broader community. I want to thank the educators in the room for accepting the awesome responsibility of developing our nation's future. And if you're a teacher or an educator, please stand up. Thank you. I didn't even have to ask you. Let's give them a big hand. I want to thank Secretary Duncan for putting a national spotlight on our public schools, for visiting Los Angeles once again to acknowledge the momentum we've created here. But I also want to thank him for challenging us to tackle the important work that lies ahead. One of our nation's earliest education reformers, Horace Mann, once said, "Education, beyond all other devices of human origin, is the great equalizer of the condition of men." And of course, we know he should have said women as well. He said, "The balance wheel of the social machinery," and that indeed is the promise of public education. But the promise of public education remains largely unfulfilled. It shouldn't matter how much money you have or what zip code you live in. But in this city and cities all across the country, it does. It shouldn't matter if you don't have money and live in the wrong neighborhood, but you may very well be trapped in a failing school. It's no secret that in Los Angeles, far too many children fall into this trap. The public school system in Los Angeles has had its share of struggles. Many families have fled the system. Many of you have sent your children to private school, much as I did. Many of you have decided to invest in alternatives, such as charters. But we have to understand something. Even with the largest number of charter schools in the country, and that's what we have here in LA, only 9% of our students are in charters. More than 90% of students, nearly 700,000 students, still attend traditional L.A.U.S.D. schools. Some of these schools are great. Many are struggling. But momentum is building. And that's why I think it's so important that all of us are here today. You see, we're on the brink of a new era of excellence in education. You may not know it, but over the past 6 years, Los Angeles has taken significant strides in reforming a broken system. Working together, and I'd like to acknowledge Monica Garcia and Yoli Flores Aguilar, who are here today. Please stand up and give them a big hand, everybody. They have a very, very tough job. You see, they created the Public School Choice Initiative, allowing anyone with a proven track record of success to compete to run new or failing schools, changing the lives of tens of thousands of kids in LA by giving their parents choices and by giving them a chance. Just last week, our school board awarded operation of 13 new campuses and focus schools to an exemplary and diverse group of school operators. By the end of this year, over 100 low-performing new schools with thousands of students will be under new leadership with a new chance for success. Now, there was a lot of controversy about that. But what do you do when a school has been failing, not just for years? We've documented some of this under Leave No Child Behind for a number of years. But some of these schools have been failing for decades. Antonio and I went to school where our kids were failing. I went to Roosevelt High School. When I ran a Roosevelt High School, 75% of the kids were dropping out. 75%. When we took over Roosevelt High School, 65% of our kids were dropping out. Some of these schools have been failing for so long that it's a statement about the lack of commitment on our part to do something dramatic. And so public school choice was an opportunity for us to say, the time is now. It's over. We're going to set a high standard for these kids. You know, I don't quote George W. very often. Didn't vote for him. I don't think I've ever in my public life and in my life as a voter, ever disagreed with someone as much as I have him. But when he talks about the soft bigotry of low expectations, he so hits it on the head. Every time I hear people tell me, well, you don't understand, Mr. Villaraigosa, these kids are poor. 95% of them are on the school lunch program. Their parents don't speak English. Their parents don't have an education. We have more homeless kids than any place. More foster kids. And the litany of excuses go on and on. And I think to myself, they're talking about me. They're talking about my mother. They're talking about many of us in this room who grew up in poverty, who grew up in a family where we were the first. And by the way, Antonio, I join you. I wasn't the first high school graduate, but I was the first college graduate. And in many ways, you know, our circumstances were changed. Nobody in my family before my mom and everyone else didn't succeed, were able to go to high school and graduate. But it's possible. And we're here today because we know that and because we're tired of the excuses. But I think it's important as well. It was said earlier that we got to get out of the blame game. We got to stop pointing fingers at teachers or principals, at business leaders, at politicians, and we've got to come together. We've got to figure it out. You know, when for years I've been saying this was a civil rights issue, and everybody pretty much shined me on, let's be honest. You know, yeah, Well, you know, I'll tell you, working with civil rights organizations and talking to them, filed a lawsuit, and we won a lawsuit to challenge seniority-based layoffs because they were disproportionately affecting the poorest schools and students of color. Now, when we did that, it was counterintuitive for some of these civil rights organizations. They had never really thought of this equal protection argument. But I said, hey, look, if the rest of the district is laying off 3% of our teachers, and the schools in Watts are losing 50% of their teachers 2 years in a row, and if they always get assigned based on, purely on seniority, and performance isn't taken into account at all, there's something wrong with that system. Well, the courts agreed, and while that case is still going through the system, I have every reason to believe that we're going to prevail. There's got to be a way for us to balance the rights of teachers and principals, to balance the issues of collective bargaining, but also the rights of kids to have a steady teacher, not a different one every single day. There's got to be a way to do that. Working together, I think we can figure it out. Working together, I think we can figure out how we put kids first. Now, working together, we made LA the proud home of more charters than any other school district in the country. In the past 5 years, we've more than doubled the number of charters here in Los Angeles. Working together, we've increased the number of school turnaround operators, making LA a national leader. But last week I was there, and the week before in San Diego, and I challenged our charter friends. And I said, look, you know, when it's all said and done, we want to put you out of business. And they looked at me and they said, well, we just gave you our elected official of the year award. Well, I said, well, thank you. I appreciate that. I really do. But we want to put you out of business. Why? We want to take all of the things you're doing to scale throughout the whole district. In the end, why are we having a public school choice? Why are we supporting success? Oh, that was the other thing. And I said, and I want your help. When you have a failing charter, we want to put them out of business now. I remember my mama. When I went to Roosevelt High School from Cathedral, in college prep classes, and they put me in shop classes, my mama went to school. And my mama said, this guy can read and write. They got into it. They said, well, those classes are full. I ended up dropping out a few months later. My mother fought for her kids. Our parents have every right to participate in the education of their kids. Now, I asked two of our school board members, and I hope I didn't miss anybody, but don't think I have, to stand up, and when I did, I asked them to stand up, and you applauded them, because I think they've proven themselves ready to make tough decisions and fight the status quo. I think they've shown in the 5 years that they've been there, 4 years in the case of one and 5 or 6 in the case of the other, that they're willing to make those tough choices. You know, we have an incoming superintendent committed to reforming the way we support, evaluate, and reward our teachers. And I'm excited about his coming. Because I think what you're going to see is the foundation that we've laid here is a foundation for transformative reform. The reforms we do here are going to have results that are going to dramatically change those statistics, but only if we work together. I think I've shown to all of those people that said oh, the mayor's only doing this because he's running for governor. The mayor's only doing this because he's looking for more power. I'm not giving up. I got 2.5 years left. And in the next 2.5 years, we're going to keep on pushing. We're going to keep on challenging. But then we got to do something else. We've got to stand up to those people in Sacramento who think that it's okay to be 47th in per pupil spending, to be at the bottom of every indicia offending class size, the bottom technology in our classrooms, the bottom in nurses per student, the bottom in librarians per student, the bottom in library books, in every indicia, we're at the bottom. How about this for a statistic to all of those who say we tax so much in California? California today, well, let me do New York. 19 million people live in New York. They have a budget of $132 billion. 19 million in New York. 37 million people in California. We have a budget of $128 billion. We are love-starving government. We're not investing in our kids anymore. And part of what we're doing here to show transformative reform and better results is to make a case. And I intend to make it with you. And that case is that we got to start funding our schools. We've got to start honoring our teachers. We've got to start giving support to transformative reform, particularly. But we have to give more support to all of our schools. I've also said that we've got to lead an internal reform effort and challenge our own union leadership. We have to work together within those unions to really say that teachers need to get in front of the reform movement. Not behind it. They need to embrace it. One of the different things about the partnership that we've created here is that we've said, hey, hold it. It's got to be bottom up. It can't be top down. It can't be a mayor on top here or just a school board. It's got to be parents in every school empowered. It's got to be teachers empowered to make decisions in their classrooms. It's got to be a strong collaborative principle that brings us together. It's got to be a city try to provide resources. It's got to be philanthropy and business and all of us engaged together. So I want to say to you that I believe that working together, we can reach the pinnacle of success here in L.A. I believe that we can set the highest standards for our kids, that our kids one day in this school district will be able to speak English and Spanish and Mandarin. You know, it's almost embarrassing that in Chicago schools there are 10,000 kids learning Mandarin now and 2,500 kids here in a city that's the gateway to China and Asia, in a city that has 50% Latinos. Our goal should be to set the highest standards. And I guarantee you, if we do that, our kids will meet and surpass those standards. So I want to thank you all for your support. I know that today is not just a conference. This is what we are doing today is we're putting together a broad-based movement of labor, of business, of philanthropy, of education leaders, of the city, of all of the real stakeholders and beneficiaries of a great public school system. It is now my honor to introduce a man who is a friend of mine. I define friendship by those who will run up the Great Wall of China with me, with all the cameras on us, and let me win. He was so cute. I won by a step. He could have beat me by a couple of lengths, but, you know, I had an operation 2 days before and ran up those steps. Help me in welcoming our moderator and the president and publisher of the Los Angeles Business Journal, Matt Toledo. Thank you all. Thank you.
Round to our mayor, Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa. Talk about a warrior for education in our community. The mayor has been for more than decades a strong advocate for our students and a great, great champion for education here in Los Angeles. Thank you very much, Mayor. I have the privilege of moderating our panel, and I think I'm supposed to call up our panelists. I thought they'd just magically appear. We're in Hollywood, right? Poof. So if I could invite our panelists to come on up stage, and we'll get started with our session this afternoon. We're running a little tight on time, so I'm going to keep my questions directed specifically to our panelists. And then if any of you have questions for any of the members of our panelists, we'd like to invite you to submit them via email to the United Way and email your questions to liveunitedforla@unitedwayla.org. Come on up. Hi, Frank. Can I have our panelists up here, please? Because I have, like, limited material. Frank, welcome. Mr. Jones and Ms. Buick. Monica, thank you. Okay, well, let's get started. We have our panel this morning is a diverse group of leaders that are focused on the issue of education, and let me take a moment to introduce each one of them. You'll find bios of each one of them in your program material. To my immediate right, we have Mr. Greg Jones, retired president and CEO of State Farm Insurance, also the chair of the California Business and Education Excellence Program. To his right, we have Ambassador Frank Baxter, chairman emeritus of Jeffries Company, and to his right, Monica Garcia, L.A.U.S.D. Board President. Monica, good morning.
Good morning.
And to her right, our very own Elise Buick, the President and CEO of United Way of Greater Los Angeles. And to her right, Dr. John Deasy, incoming L.A.U.S.D. Superintendent. Welcome, all of you. Let's give them a big round of applause. Thank you for being here. Well, good morning, panel. We've heard some alarming statistics this morning, some troubling information. As a businessman, for me, it's more than depressing, it's motivational. I look at when things are so bad and we're all focused on making an impact and a difference, it shouldn't take too much to start moving the needle and making an impact. So Dr. Deasy, I'm going to start with you if I can. The most alarming statistic for me is the dropout rate, over 50%. As the incoming superintendent, share with us your plans to deal with this, what I think is the most profound and critical statistic and issues that relates to education here.
Yeah, thank you. A couple of things. One is Ms. Haycock's data and knowing LAUSD, it's very important that we think about this issue quite clearly, that poverty is not destiny, and it is not inevitable that we're at the bottom or going to remain at the bottom. I mean, so when you talk about what are our plans and what is my administration's work in preparing to radically change those trajectories for youth, well, first, because it is their right, it's their civil right for high achievement, that all youth graduate college workforce ready and are able to go to and through post-secondary. Part of it is cultural. The mayor said this, our speaker said this, Ms. Haycock said this. Do not tell us that kids can't achieve at high levels. That's garbage. Kids in LA can achieve at very high levels. They can remain achieving at high levels, and it's our obligation to facilitate from happening. So the cultural aspect of disbelief in youth or belief that those figures are where we're going to be, there's no place for that in the administration. Second piece is to work relentlessly and quite clearly about access. Students get to get into high-end, rigorous courses. Students fundamentally get to get into the A through G curriculum and be successful there. We're not successful at that at the moment. We intend to be fairly relentless about that issue. They also have access, and we will demand and provide access to the most effective teaching in schools led by the most effective administrators. We drilled down and planned to be quite clear about the fact that instruction matters. Leadership at our schools is the center point of how we're going to turn the trajectory around quite quickly and helping people learn to be highly effective at this issue of instruction. It is not just a natural skill that you think you can teach. It is a well-developed, complex set of skills that we will work side by side with our staff. I see amazing teaching taking place, and I see it in isolation, and I see it fragmented, and I don't see it supported nearly to the degree that we're going to do that around that piece. And lastly, we're going to be very clear about removing impediments to the core work that we're going to do. And those impediments can come in the forms of policies or laws or current expectations that kids' rights first around this issue. And we are going to approach the issue of both of effectiveness and approach the issue of high achievement and rights. We'll do that through negotiation, but we're also going to do it through regulation, and we're also going to do it through legislation and litigation if necessary, so that there is actually no barrier to the opportunity for students. And lastly, we're going to be very transparent about being clear what's expected of us. And so we're going to lead this to a very strong performance management system. Targets are going to be posted. Accountability is going to be quite transparent for the adults. We put a stake in the ground. We don't want graduation rates to get better. We want it at 74% in 3 years. And then we want it 100% in 6 years. And we want to measure it, and we want to drive that and cascade that through the organization. We don't really hope that access rates get better. We want 100% of youth by 2016 inside and succeeding in an A through G curriculum. It is, quite frankly, the policy. And we don't really want to sit around and hope we can get there. It is quite clear we would get there. And lastly, we want to support union membership who at the moment are coming up with some absolutely amazing, thoughtful reforms. I am blown away by where the membership is moving on some of the edgiest and most rigorous reforms, and they know it because they are in it. So part of the obligation is for the central to become leaner, thinner, more agile in direct support of teachers. It's a little bit about how we're working on this.
Well, that's a great answer to what was intended to be a narrow question. And I think for a lot of the people, I didn't mean that as a joke, I mean as a compliment, seriously. A lot of people in the audience, this is their first time hearing you. Some people have been acquainted with you in the past. And I think they share my enthusiasm for your passion and for your leadership and for the impact that I believe you're going to have on our young people and our students in the years to come. So we look forward to your leadership, and I applaud you.
Yeah, I don't want to be spending my Sundays through my church visiting the camps. Okay? That's where it is a sobering reality when you have to go and see whom we've lost. We'll work to bring them back, but that pipeline has to end. We want to be spending Sundays through my church actually visiting an overwhelming freshman class at the UC campuses. That's where we want to be.
Very good. Thank you very much, Dr. Deasy. Mr. Jones, I'm going to come over to you, get a business, more of a business perspective. Greg Jones, you've been a deeply involved in education, former member of the State Board of Education. Currently, you're co-chair of the Department of Education's 12th Grade Preparedness Commission. As a business leader, share with us why education should be and is a business issue, and why should and how should businesses get involved?
Well, it's a great question, Matt, and there really are two questions there, the why and the how.
Are you mic'd up?
I am. How's that?
Perfect.
Okay. And so what I was saying, that those are two kind of separate questions, the why and the how. The why gets to be pretty obvious. You look at the numbers that Katie put up there this morning, and they obviously, you know, are staggering.
Thank you.
All right.
You gotta get undressed there. To...
Just leave that there, please. It'll just be a moment.
All right.
Yeah.
today.
Perfect. Much better.
We're hot.
Okay. You know, I'm going to go back to some of the things that the numbers that Katie put up there, I think, are extremely important, and they really get to the why. You know, first of all, I think for the United Way to put this together is tremendous, because you bring a lot of, well, I know we have a lot of educators here, to bring the business community into this is absolutely critical, because business has to be a part of the solution, and has to be at the table on the issues that we're talking about, because there really is, when you think about it, those of you in the audience that are business people and business leaders, who has a greater stake at the outcome? Because these students that we're talking about, at the end of the day, they're going to come to see you, because almost all of these students are going to be in business. They're going to be in big business, small business, their own business, nonprofit, profit. And so all of those people are our future workforce, obviously, and our future customers. So, you know, as business leaders, we know there are some things that are very relevant to this issue. You know, we know, and somebody, I think our first speaker mentioned this morning, that we operate as business people in a different kind of global competitive marketplace than we did ever before. And we know that if we're going to compete in that marketplace, our ability to compete is going to be dependent largely on our workforce. And the quality of our workforce ultimately is going to be dependent upon the quality of education that they receive. So clearly, there's no question that there's a stake for business in this. And I think the fact of the matter is that schools cannot and should not be expected to go it alone. I think that the business community has to be a part of that. The education challenges, I think, that we have in this country exceed the capacity for schools and educators to solve them alone. So I think that the business community has to be a part of that. And again, when you think about the numbers that we saw up here, now consider that in L.A.U.S.D., 80% of the students are black, brown, and or poor. And so you overlay that in terms of the numbers that you see, and consider that, for a large part, that is our future workforce. And as you know, as well as I do, the needs of and the skill sets that are required in the business community are going like that. When you think of the skills that you need today relative to what they were 5 years ago, and when you think about the skills that you're going to need compared 5 years from now, they're going to continue to go up, while at the same time, the achievement of 80% of students is level at best. So, I mean, clearly, I think that establishes the need for the business community to be involved. You know, when I was the chairman, I'm not the chairman now, but when I was chairman of the Business Roundtable, I traveled up and down the state, and I talked to CEOs up and down this state. And they talked about jobs unfilled. A lot of jobs that required college degrees. And they talked about not being able to find quality candidates to fill those jobs. And, you know, clearly that is a problem for those businesses, but it's beyond that. It is a problem for our state, and it's a problem for our country. Because for every job that goes unfulfilled, there are goods and services that we can't deliver to the marketplace. And in turn, there are dollars we can't return to the U.S. economy. Mm-hmm. And so that's a bigger issue, and it certainly underscores the importance of business being involved in this whole education debate. Now, how do we go about doing that? I think first and foremost is this. And by the way, Elise, I hope and I know the intent here. This isn't just a learning exercise. I think it's a call to action. Mm-hmm. I think it's a call to action from everybody here, business, education, in partnership, trying to address these issues that are so critical and are before us. And, you know, as from a business perspective, you know, we need to find ways to work in partnership with education to see where we can offer the greatest value and add value to this issue. And I think there are several things that we have to understand, Matt.
you know, that business, I think, has a responsibility here. We have a responsibility, first of all, to be involved. We have a tendency, and all of you are involved because you're here. But frankly, business has not been at the table as much as they should have been, in my view. And so we can't sit on the sideline and complain about all the things that aren't happening. We've got to find ways to get involved. We've got to do things like, in my view, I think we, because we know what the marketplace is going to require. You know, so I think that we have to help define learning outcomes. And by learning outcomes, I mean, you know, we need to really focus on rigor and relevance in the curriculum. We need to really help understand that we need more. We need more math, we need more science, we need more rigor in our curriculums. The knowledge-based economy obviously requires that. We've got to provide, I think, better feedback than we have in the past to the degree that students are acquiring the kind of skills and mastering the skills that they need to be successful. And so those are the things, I think hopefully the business community finds ways and finds avenues for those for those partnerships and adds value where I think, you know, we are best. Because if the business community is good at anything, it is good at understanding, translating the power of a good idea. And so how do we go about understanding, you know, what are the things that are working and how do we scale the things that are working? And, you know, I guess from my time on the State Board of Education, I'm not on there right now, but if I learned anything from that experience, I think it's this. In my opinion, too much time is spent on, let me say a disproportionate amount of time is spent on experimentation, on faddish trends, you know, as opposed to systematically replicating things that work and scientifically kind of proven strategies that are out there that have that are working in schools today that have sustained success over time. And so to the degree that we can be involved in that, I think is a degree that the business community can contribute to the ultimate success. And if I could just make one more comment, it kind of relates to something that Katie talked about.
Last quickly. Comment.
She showed some numbers and she went by some very quickly, but I think they're really important. It's this whole issue of college readiness. Mm-hmm. Today in L.A., or in California, or in L.A., 60% of high school students need remedial education when they go to college, when they go to CSU. 60%. Now she talked about some numbers. She showed some numbers for African Americans and Latinos. So those numbers were 2%, 3%. Ready for college. Ready meaning, they don't need remedial education. I just want to put those numbers in perspective. That means that in the L.A.U.S.D., African Americans, that 2% represents 20 African American students. 20 African-American students are ready for college without remediation in math. 277 Latinos are ready for college without remediation. There are more people in this room than there are African-Americans and Latinos ready for college based upon those numbers.
Well, that is a sobering fact. I want to get a board perspective. So, Monica, I'm going to come to you, if I might, for just a moment, and share with us what changes in your mind the LAUSD Board of Education would need to implement to help improve the graduation rate.
So thank you all for being here. Thank you, United Way. I love having partners. What the board needs to do is to keep being a place where the best in
the
country want to work. So I know that we have part of, here's the great news today. Things were worse 3 years ago. We're on a trajectory of getting better, and I love what Dr. Deasy said. We have to pick up the pace. So one of the reasons we've been able to be a district that is moving towards the light is because Ramon Cortinez has been our superintendent. We need the best in the country to come and help move this organization. John Deasy needs the best in the country to help. So it's not about one person or one term of anybody. This is a systemic reform, and we're never going to go backwards. So we need to be the board where people want to come and be part of the team. We need to keep our focus on what is going on in the classroom and in the schools. Because when we do that, we know we've studied the problem and we know the solution is before us. There are kids succeeding and we have to do more of that. And then I think we have to continue to grow the movement. Whatever your perspective, this is a movement, whether it's towards economic justice, educational justice, social justice, we are picking up partners every day, and thank God for the United Way that knows how to do it better than everybody. But we have an LA compact where we've invited everyone who wants to come and be helpful to us in the 100% graduation mission. We need to create a working relationship with teacher membership and teacher leadership. And we know that in order to pick up the pace, we need to figure out a way to move forward. Too many kids are counting on us, and the taking sides conversation is not helpful. I think lastly, we have to remember that it's very difficult. This is a very difficult place, and when we think that people do the best they can, it really has to inspire us that to think about the system work, to think about it's personal to everybody. So we have a lot of kids in right before us that want to be graduates, but they're really struggling to read. So I love the personal conversation when we all take a moment and say, I needed to know how to read and write to be able to do what I do. I needed other people to invest in me in order to do what I do. And the possibilities are great. So I'm extremely optimistic. And this Board of Education has just gone through an election. We're going to be a team July 1 for another 24 months. And all of you should hold us accountable to make sure that graduation is going up and that we're learning how to take obstacles out of the way. And then together, let's go to Sacramento and let's go to Washington and tell them they have to support us. And we'll all be able to do that with Arne Duncan a little bit later on, I think.
Very good.
Ambassador Baxter, I'm going to turn to you, if I might, for a moment. You've been investing in, studying, and engaged in education. I hope you're like me and you're an optimist that you believe that the education system can be fixed. But if so, can it be sustained? What are your thoughts about our current condition, and can improvement be sustained?
Thank you, Matt. I think that for the first thing, the metaphor of fixing a failed system is a very misleading metaphor. It's not so much a failed system, it's basically an obsolete system. It's a system that was devised in the 19th century, the middle of the 19th century, to prepare an illiterate society to meet the needs of the 19th century moving into industrialization. So we basically used a factory model, and each grade is kind of like something on the assembly line. We still have that model. It worked very well in the 19th century. Virtually by the end of the 19th century, almost everyone had graduated from grammar school. Almost everyone could read. 50% of the population had gone from farms into industry. About 6% of the kids had graduated from high school. About 2% had graduated from college. As Katie described earlier, the needs went up, and the system, although it was already obsolete, adapted. And how did it adapt? It adapted because there was the availability of underpaid, highly qualified women who couldn't get a job anywhere else except teaching or nursing. And that persisted way up until the 60s when those women are now sitting up here. They're doing many other things besides teaching and nursing. And the system from that time started falling down. And what we have right now is that the average person going into teaching today, and there are many, many exceptions to that, is in the bottom third of the SAT scores. They leave within 5 years. Half of them leave within 5 years. 30% leave within 2 years. So what we're trying to do is to fix a model that is unfixable. You do not have the availability of human resources to do what we were able to do in the 19th century, in the first part of the 20th century. Fortunately, there is an answer that makes me very, very optimistic, and that's being tried. Now, as Katie said earlier, there are a lot of examples of groups that are doing very, very well. I'm happy to be a chairman of the Alliance for College Ready Public Schools, which has, it's a charter management organization. It has six middle schools and 12 high schools. And we are turning out hundreds of Antonio Carreras every year. And most of these kids come in, as we've heard earlier, they come into the ninth grade, usually at the third or fourth grade level from LA Unified. And unfortunately, Katie's right, it would be better if they knew how to read well in the fourth grade. But the wonderful, wonderful thing that makes me so confident is how resilient the students are. They come in having been told most of their lives that they're not going to make it, and somehow it's their fault, with a self-esteem way down to here. But within weeks, when we tell them that they can learn, we know they can learn, we can help them learn if they help themselves, if their parents help them, and we graduate 85% of them. We graduate 100% of them, 85% are accepted in four-year universities. So any child can learn. But what we're doing is not sustainable. We are making the very best of an obsolete system, basically, by having good management, good controls, good teachers, et cetera. But we're reaching about 7,000 kids, which has said there are 700,000 kids in L.A. Unified. What we have started to do with two of our schools is that about half to three quarters of their time is spent online, learning math, learning science, learning reading, and each one of those students finally is being taught at their level. When you think of it, in the average class, about a third of the kids are with the teacher, a third are ahead and bored, and a third are behind and thinking about something else. Each one of these kids is learning at their own level. And when we talk about the digital divide, they're not, at least in Los Angeles, at least in Watts, where these kids are, there's no digital divide. They all know how to operate online. They all have access to a computer. So they just jump right into it. The teachers like it because they have time to do one-on-ones, do small groups, and not just spend their time with the routine of lectures. And they came, we just have done this for 1 year, but there are many examples across the country. There's actually a school just nearby that all the second graders are getting their math online. But they came in with the average third grade level. Now they're way beyond the sixth grade level after four or five months, really loving it. So I really applaud the enthusiasm of Monica and John for making a difference, but without changing the model. I mean, like, can you fix a Model T? Sure. Can you fix a Model A? Sure. But there's a better model, which is called a blended model, where it's partially human, partially technology, but more time spent on technology. And it would be nice if we got more money, but ladies and gentlemen, reality is an acquired taste. Do you think in this state there's going to be any more money coming for a long time to come? So what we need to do is embrace the hand that we're dealt. Now I know that we're talking about our improvement here and all those lines that did better in us and all the other cities. They're not doing very well at all. So they talk about growth, an incremental growth that if you extrapolate over 20 or 30 years, they'll get to where they want to be. But we can sort of pat ourselves on the back that we've grown a bit, or we have anecdotal growth like some of the charter schools. But if you want to really have systemic, sustainable growth that will last, you have to come into the 21st century. And I know that the changes that both Bodica and John are talking about, that they'll make terrific improvements, but I want them to last after they're long gone, after I'm long gone. And the only way to do that is a blended method using a lot of technology, being able to afford only the best teachers rather than trying to replicate the 40,000 teachers, some of whom are good, some who can't be so good. And we can win this, but we have to take our shackles off. And the state like the school in Carson, have to do their stuff after school because there's so many rules about seat time and things that are designed, again, for the 19th century. I mean, we're set up for the 19th century. I mean, we still have the summers off for the harvest, but let's come into the 21st century. We can do that, and I'm so glad to see the middle class here because we have been dropping out. We've taken care of our own personal problems. We sent our kids to a private school or moved into a neighborhood where we thought the schools are good. They're not nearly as good as you think they are. Believe me, they're not. But now we need to march on Sacramento. Things like the parent tricker, the school choice, these are all good systems, but they're really designed to do a little better job at the old system. And it's just not going to work. It cannot work. So what I'm really just advocating to the people here and to these wonderful leaders of our school system to do things. And one great possibility this year, while there's so little time and money, the average math teacher, I don't know about LA Unified, but in California, 70% of them do not have a math background. Math can be taught so well and so effectively and so quickly online that what I would suggest to our leaders is to take at least part as we're letting teachers go, is to supplement them with some math problems. And I know, I mean, if you want your kids to learn math, bring them to Watts, to our schools, and for sure that they will learn it. That can be done in LA Unified now, pragmatically, without, you know, hope without hope. Hope is not an option. It's not a business plan either. It's not a plan. So I would just urge everyone here to take the shackles off. And I'm glad that there is the union leaders are taking the leadership. When the printing press came along, there was probably a monks union that tried to stop it. But technology is inevitable. It's going to happen. I mean, we have ATMs, we have iPods, iPads, I this and I that. But what I would like to see, and I would like us all to cooperate, is to not to lose another generation or another couple of generations, and when it either takes place incrementally or as a result of a crisis. And we can do it together. If we want to do it, we have to use the tools. We have to diagnose what the situation is. And I think that it can be done in LA. And let's get started today. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Elise, I want to give you a little airtime, but before I give you a little airtime, I want everybody to join me in congratulating and thanking you for your leadership in putting on this wonderful summit. You know, United Way has been such an important part of our community under your leadership, and I'm just interested in your thoughts about the role that United Way is and should be taking relative to the conversation around education.
Well, thank you, Matt, and I just want to thank everyone for being here. You're what is making today a success, and I think the overwhelming interest and demand to be here just speaks volumes about the amount of people in our community who really want to get involved and make a difference. And I think that is the role of the United Way. I think it's a very different role for us, but we really realize that we do have partners all across the community. We have partners in business, we have partners with other funders, we have partners with labor, and that's what it's about. We all have to be in the same room, hearing the same information, the same strategies, and working together, and mobilizing people. I think your comment about a movement, it's just the time is now where we've got to get in the game and we've got to get involved. And I'm really proud of our board and all of our constituents that are here, is that we have to advocate for change. We have to demand that we are not going to wait and let another kid slip through the cracks. Dr. Deasy was mentioning Antonio has a sister right now who's at Garfield High who is on a dropout path. So you being here today, us demanding for change, us demanding for accountability and transparency is really part, I think, of the United Way's role and galvanizing the community, and we are now advocating. We advocate at the school board, we need to advocate in Sacramento, and it's about our voices being heard. The other two things I just want to highlight is that we really are focused on middle schools. We know where the dropout factories are, and middle school is one of our best chances to kind of get kids on the right track. So we're really investing a lot of our resources at the United Way and really focusing on low-performing middle schools, focusing on providing rigorous after-school tutoring, mentoring, focusing on getting those reading and English scores up, and also investing in principals. This has been a new effort for us. We agree with Dr. Deasy about leadership, that leadership matters. And we've been really honored to partner with the California League of Middle Schools, because you're going to hear later today in the breakout, against all the odds, high poverty schools, high populations. One school I went to had 25% of their kids are homeless. These principals are beating the odds, and they're doing it through their leadership. They have high expectations of their youth and their parents. They're really creating an environment where they support teachers and give them meaningful feedback. So there is hope that we see it working, and now we got to scale it. I think another really important component for us at the United Way is how we engage parents and students. My kids go to LAUSD, and I will tell you, even with all of my knowledge, it is very hard for me as a parent to navigate the school and to navigate the district. So we've been really happy and pleased with this board to really work on tools for parents and students so that they can become better advocates for their kids. So you may know there's a school report card, and I actually got one in the mail for my son, and it shows you, without a doubt, no disputing it, here is what's happening in your child's school. So our role in making sure that parents know about this valuable tool and mobilizing them is very important. So we're really here to be a partner on this, and I'm just thrilled at the turnout and the response today, because it shows me that people care and they want to get in the game.
Very good. Dr. Deasy, you know, Frank mentioned that the system, in his judgment, is obsolete, 19th century system. We're in the 21st century. I'm interested in your reaction to his statement or his perspective about our system.
So the first comment I would have is, the evidence is overwhelming that you're absolutely correct. So it's not an opinion. We know that that's not working. We've known that it is not working for all kids. And I think, as you gave the data and the history, we had different sets of expectations for different groups of youth 50 and 100 years ago. The country no longer has that. It has one set of expectations. They're very high, they're universal, and we consider them a youth's right. And so the same system that did that can no longer actually do this at that level. I think reaction to a couple of pieces. This is really not about reform. This is about transformation. And it's about transformational leadership, transformational teaching, transformational governance leadership, as we see with our Board of Education. And I think that that makes people uncomfortable. And the pace with which the improvements are going to take place are going to make some people uncomfortable. And my response is, okay, do you want to know what real uncomfortableness? It's not graduating. Real comfortableness is having no options. Real uncomfortableness is no hope for healthcare. Real being really uncomfortable is a prison pipeline. Now that's uncomfortable. We want people to be understanding that some of this discomfort is because we have an obligation to do for the other in ways that we've never done before. Our administration is very, very laser focused. We have simple, clear 5 core beliefs, and we are driven from that. Start with children. You start with students. That has to be the anchor. It has to be the litmus test. It's where we're going to move around this piece. Parents are partners. Families are partners, not in a token sense, not in like I hope you come to school and give us compliment sense, or that you fill out a survey and tell me things are going okay sense. Most parents, most guardians, most caregivers come to school because they are struggling, not because that they are thrilled and happy. And the notion for the school system to legitimately respond to that is an acquired skill. We intend to build that so that we have authentic voice. That is very transformational. The third thing is that the notion that success is in the classroom. It's not at Beaudry. It's not in the local district offices, with all due respect. It is in the classroom. The center of school, so that we can have a system of great schools, is how we think about a service organization around the middle, this kind of vast, huge piece that we call the middle, and trying to focus that. You can't teach what you don't learn, and students can't learn if you don't know how to teach. It's the system's obligation to help that piece. Technology is going to be a portion of how we do that. The blended model piece, we already know that that is working. Take a look at Rocket Ship, for example, schools in California, your own schools in your organization, as proof points about this happening, and other schools outside of the California area. It will never fully replace the critical need for highly effective leadership, thoughtful and skilled counseling and outstanding teaching, but it is a huge assist if we're expected to do this at pace and scale that we're going to do. Fourth piece around this is that really effective teaching and leadership and accountability are the keys to our success. That is how we're really focused. I really enjoy the conversation here, and what one thing I took about this is no place for blame or shame, but there's absolutely no place for excuses. So we don't want into a conversation about blame. I don't want into a conversation about shame because youth watch us. But we're very much going to be clear that there are no excuses because we know it's possible. You visit schools, you lead schools, we know where it's happening. And it can happen at a much larger pace for many folks. LAUSD is going to be a talent magnet. I mean, it's going to be a place where you're losing if you're actually not inside working. So if you think about the country and you think about what's out there at the moment, if you want to be in a place where it's going to happen and happen quickly for youth, then you really need to pack your bags and come and work both inside and outside for LAUSD. Otherwise, you'll be one of those footnotes who will be saying, God, I wish I was there when that was transformation was taking place around that period of time. We've touched on a topic. Let's just kind of put it out there. This notion of being no shame, no blame, but no excuses, that requires courage in the conversation. Well, one of the courageous conversations that we are going to have is about finding a new, thoughtful, productive way forward with labor. The idea that you can't do something because it's, quote, in the contract, and that's kind of ridiculous on its surface. If it needs to be done, we find ways to do that. And it means that we have to call out conversations that are sometimes uncomfortable. It's not about bullying. It's certainly not about blaming remarkable teachers and remarkable leaders, but it's about saying, this is a barrier. It doesn't serve students. And if we start with students, and if parents are our partners, and effective teaching is going to be the key to success, then if there's a barrier there, we need to actually have that conversation. And I am looking forward to the belief in this country that the envy of labor would be to be in contract transformation in LAUSD. And I think that that is decidedly possible. Huge assumption of trust, but decidedly possible. The flip side of that piece is we actually can't wait any longer for that to happen. I believe deeply that labor is necessary in this country. I am of that, believe in that, but the old model doesn't work. I mean, and we're getting examples and glimpses inside of LAUSD across, we have, you know, everybody knows this, multiple unions. It's not just about UTLA. It's, of course, involving UTLA. But it's every one of our labor partners finding ways to support their membership and youth simultaneously in a transformational way. I mean, it's been the hallmark of this state for a long time. I'm looking forward to leading that. I hope you call us to task to reflect, if not annually, every couple of years. And I think one of the things that would be very potent for me is if people want to say, you know, we did it. Well, I think did it, D-I-D, is really people want to know how they can be part of this work. You know, demand, invest, and deliver. Demand that it can be better than it is now. You know, voices can't just come one day at a board meeting a month or one day at a protest a year. It has to be a constant drumbeat that this must be better for youth. And invest. When we launched the LA Fund for Public Education, which is designed to support and leverage change inside of LA, people can make an investment in that work. I don't have a lot of hope that Sacramento is going to be coming to the rescue on lots of work. They should at least, for God's sakes, keep the amount of money that we have now. Right. We're not asking for any more. We're asking for the minimum amount, kind of the pathetic amount that we're trying to run our schools with at the moment. Don't take that away from us. But lastly, deliver. People have roles throughout the community. I was so honored and impressed by the notion of where business can be and where they actually have been and stepping up that piece. I think that's what I'm looking for in the next couple of years.
Thank you, Dr.
Thanks.
Frank, I want to invite you to have your comment, and then I will have one question for all the panelists with a very short answer from each of you. Ambassador Baxter.
I'll make a short comment that I just want to second what the superintendent has said about the grassroots, that the changes are only going to be made from the bottom, from the people. I think the two big things for me are technology and the changes. The status quo is so defended at the top that it's a barrier that it's very difficult to get through. You know, the choice movement happened because we had a great school board, but we also had 3,000 parents showing up saying, we want change. But all of those were poor parents. There was no one from the middle class. And the legislature for years has been getting away with murder, putting in barriers to improvement. So I would just like to ask everyone to get involved, get in the game, that democracy is not a spectator sport. And it affects all of us. I mean, this emergency, it's a little bit like high blood pressure. You don't see the symptoms, but they're out there in terms of our economic competitiveness, in terms of our social problems, unemployment, crime, healthcare, et cetera. So commit to do something today, everyone, please.
Greg, I'm going to start with you. Short answer, name one thing that you're committed to continuing doing or starting to do to help improve and help continue to have an impact of the young people, the students of this region. Greg?
Well, I think, speaking for me and the business community, you have to embrace the notion that business has to be involved, that you'll find a way to get involved in your local communities and with those that, you know, are those organizations like United Way and others that are serious about education reform.
Get involved, right?
Continue to bring more blended learning to our charter school management, to tell as many people as possible about it. We've invited a lot of school leaders to our schools to see that it can be done right now, that we can, unlike what Katie said, that you're stuck if you don't get it in the second grade, that we have resilient 13, 14, 15, 16-year-olds that with some help, and this also applies with special ed. It's amazing how our special ed kids are advancing with technology. So I'm going to, with every center of my body, I'm going to keep working it to get it to as many kids as possible.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Ambassador.
I think it's our turn to lead, friends, and I'm inviting leadership every day from every piece of our organization, and I'm counting on all of us to express the emergency every day that our children feel, because they're counting on us.
Please.
We're committed to continuing to mobilize the grassroots, because we so agree with Ambassador Baxter. Change doesn't happen unless we all get in the game. So we will inform and offer opportunities for people to get involved and get in the game, because that's where change is going to happen.
Dr. Deasy, you get the last word.
So two parts. First, we will not rest until we reverse the cuts. And second of all is we will be respectfully intolerant of anything that is in the way of youth learning at high levels.
Great. I have one more question. One more question. The final question is for all of you. That's what are each of you going to do? What can each one of you do this year to make a commitment or recommit to making an impact and transforming the education of our young people, because they deserve it? We've talked this morning about a movement. So I'd like you to stand up. I'd like you to stand up if you believe in education. I'd like you to stand up right now if you're committed to our children. I'd like you to stand up and give a big round of applause to our panelists and thank them for their support and their commitment and their dedication. And I thank you for your commitment. Thank you very much. Thank you to our panel. We're going to continue our program at 10 o'clock. The leadership session will be held in the West Hall, number 403. The teaching session will be held in West Hall, number 408. I encourage all of you to take advantage of the opportunity to engage in the conversations that will be held in those specific halls. Thank you again for being here. Have a great day. Thank you.